Very, very good choice to be here in the Congress Hall right now, because coming up now are one of the great thinkers and the great makers in the last years in Germany. I think you all know the unbelievable story of Dr. Bruno Seltzer, and you know Professor Dr. Miriam Meckel, who is now editor-in-chief of the Wirtschaftswoche, and Dr. Bruno Seltzer now is the CEO of Bench, former CEO Alice Carter, and boss. It sounds a little bit poetic what we're doing right now, building a benchmark for social butterflies. What it's all about, they will talk about it right now, serendipity and innovation. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Dr. Miriam Meckel and Dr. Bruno Seltzer, live at the DMEXCO 2016. Hallo, welcome.
So hello everybody, nice to have you here. We are just rightly starting this conversation. We have about half an hour, which is not much to talk about, not much time to talk about a lot of interesting things. And Bruno, I would like to start with a question. What's so amazing about a butterfly that you like made a whole audience group around it?
Correct, yeah. So these social butterflies, how we call them, are as a group a part of the millennials, so quite young people, or the Generation Y. So and this part is even more digital driven and social media active than anyhow the millennials are. So they are active, they share everything with their friends, they have a kind of a feeling of their own style, so a lot of things come together, so that for a stylish brand like Bench, it makes sense to focus on that audience.
A butterfly just touches upon everything once in a while. It's not very steady in staying somewhere. So loyalty issues, as we know them from regular businesses, to put it like that, have to be looked at differently, I guess, in your...
No, exactly right. There is a kind of a loyalty, but this loyalty is more loyalty for weeks or months and not for years. So in so far, these people always are very early adopters, even innovators. So they try things first. They are around with gadgets and they have a lot of interest activities. So it's extremely difficult to focus or to get their attention and take them in our case, in the area of fashion. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, as we are a fashion brand, to play with fashion, and as a fashion brand, we are very closely linked to music. Also, fashion and music and digital makes a lot of sense. In so far, we have a chance, but it's a tough job.
Let's stick for a moment to the peculiarities or the specificities of social butterflies. If you look at it from a business point of view, how do you address those people? Like understanding that they're really independent, that they change their loyalties. What business expectations do they have towards a brand like Bench?
Yeah. So first of all, my finding so far is we can't have them exclusively. Any try to get social butterflies exclusive for a brand, forget it. So it's more we are in their view, in their kind of general interest. So second, not everything what we do there can be measured. Very often it's more a factor of instinct. Give you one example, we, as I said, we are close to music. So we have a working together with Rudy Mendel. We had in New York, in Central Park, they had a big thing, and we did all our media there and pictures and so on. And we did everything with Snapchat. So, and I can't even say afterwards what was what is correct? Was it the right approach? Or so should we have done it in a more normal way? So all of these things is, as we are very early in what we do, my finding is to be very flexible, very open, take these people as they are, not as we want them to be, and then just move as a fashion brand their way of living, styling, things they are interested in.
How old are you?
I'm over 25.
Over 25. Unfortunately, the same is true for me. So we have two blinds talking about color, in a way, here today. To be serious, how do you manage to be in touch with this group of people being not like directly part of
exactly.
this age group?
Yeah, exactly. So it's not me directly that I feel all these trends and tendencies. It's more important for me that I know people who are living in that crowd. So this is the decisive thing. And so far this works. So, but of course, I'm not directly in the target group, also not fashion-wise, because this kind of fashion, what we offer, this street style, youth culture style, on average, our core customers are, let's say, below 30 core customers. On the other hand, it works so far.
What percentage is Bench of you today?
Today this is Bench, this is G-Star, this is Salomon, so it's a combination of everything. I have a jacket outside, but here is too hot, which is also Bench. So
about a third, like up to 50% with the jacket.
Exactly.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You said it's necessary to have people being really really diving into this group, being very close to the group, to the customers. But I can't imagine that you as a CEO will be able to really get things going without being in touch very much as well. So what do you do yourself to keep up?
Let's say Bench, as I said, is linked to music, is linked also to festivals, everything what is going on there, and everything what can be linked to a total look, to a kind of a fashion style look. I have a lot of experience in how to do that. Secondly, I always, in my whole career, was inspired by very young people. This is not just for Bench, for all fashion brands. The decisive thing is to have a feeling of the behavior, interests, activities of young people.
Am I right in saying that this means it's not just about fashion, it's about creating a kind of lifestyle community, people can dive in, stay for a while, and then exit to go somewhere else?
Exactly, yeah. And what we are interested in, people who are interested in fashion, not even that we force them to know a lot. It's just about expressing their own personality. So, to connect them to our brand, offer them activities, come together in parties, in festivals, see how we develop fashion, bring into our design development their own ideas, tell us what's good, what's bad, which kind of fashion development they would like to have. So, and then we measure whether these people, hopefully growing and growing, whether these people stay with us. So, and the percentage they stay with us is relatively high, which is a good sign. So obviously, they are not just interested in one spot. Oh, this is Bench, and then we walk away. They stay with us. This is a good sign that obviously, so far, we achieved a kind of a stable basis for further developing the brand in this kind of direction.
How do you work with influencers? Means those people in that respective group who are very influential, who have a great network, who like to spread their preferences, their interests to others. Do you manage them or try to manage them?
Exactly. This is also one of our big target groups, so these professional people around fashion. These are fashion bloggers, these are influencers, these are other bloggers within this kind of business, The good thing for us is we offer events and activities, so they can then come into our activities, events, they can meet Rudimental, they can meet Jess Glynn before. So insofar we are relevant for them. They get through us a kind of a relevant content. And so far it matches. The important thing is that we have enough what we do. To give you one example, just in Europe, we are around on a yearly basis at 25 festivals. So these are then 25 chances in a calendar year in Europe, plus US and Canada, where people come together and share their festival impressions, Connection Munich, music, and this connection to fashion.
That's the real life experience on
yes.
festivals.
All of these are real life
Still experiences. Very important, yeah. seems
right.
to be.
Yeah.
What about a more data-driven approach? Yeah. Do you do big data analysis, social media analysis, to really understand where the influencers are and where they are going?
Yes, that's what we do. And as also that the Mexico shows here, there are thousands of approaches to do that and always fine-tune that and get a better database and knowing more and more about the existing customers. This is one part of our business. On the other hand, with all of that, we know a lot about our existing customer base and their existing activities and actions. So, fashion always should go one step further. So, we should not take this as a closed shop, so just see what happened today and yesterday, but open up and be open for new ideas, new technologies for the future. To make a long story short, we do all of this, analyzing the existing customer base, existing behavior, but we constantly try to find new ideas, new approaches, new tendencies, fashion-wise or activity-wise, and then see, will it work or not?
That's a great description of a term I really love, which is serendipity, which means the unplanned, not strategically planned at least, encounter with something I haven't known or somebody I haven't known before. How do you manage this mixture of a little bit of planning and strategy on the one hand side and surprise, opening up to right. creativity, to new ideas, to the unexpected on the other hand?
Right. So I very much like this term, serendipity, but it's exactly as you say, it's unplanned, but it's not just by accident. I very much believe in finding a new thing, an unexpected thing, is based on a lot of work before. In our case, this means we are around in this fashion crowd, we are around in London, in hot spots, we know about what's going on in music, who could be interested, so all of these things then, if we are around in all the activities of our social butterfly crowd, we have the chance to create this unplanned success. So this is for me the decisive thing. We have to be as close as possible in the world of our, you name it, target group in the old wordings, or with this social
community.
Yeah.
Do you remember an important serendipitous encounter or something that happened to you serendipitously in your life?
You mean not just in bench, but also before, or at bench?
Maybe at bench, but you can share a love story, whatever you want.
I could, but I don't share that. But let's say one thing.
That's sad for us.
Last year, we started working together with Jess Glynn. So we found her because a very cool girl, very nice kind of music, very cool crowd around her. We met her by accident in London a couple of times. And then we said, it makes sense to work together, even to do a capsule collection, things like that. So we signed the contract, and 2 weeks later, Jess Glynn did win the Grammy Award for electronic music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is, in a way, a serendipity, because 2 weeks later, I think I couldn't afford. So it was just being around, perhaps having a kind of a feeling, could this be or become a big thing? It became a big thing. Mm-hmm. Now, rudimental. Cool guys, London band, very international. So it seems for us to be the next big thing. Mm-hmm. Very good picture, videos, people share. They like our audience, the social butterflies, like the band. Wherever we then bring social influencers, fashion bloggers, together with the brand. We did this 4 weeks ago in London. We already feel, and it's a lot of feeling in our business, that this works. It's more, first it starts with a feeling whether it works, and then it ends in, can I measure that?
Would you say in fashion, serendipity is a precondition for success?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. All the big trends started in this kind of people were around, and then the serendipity approach was a combination of extremely high know-how of a lot of things coming together, the right timing, and the right zeitgeist feeling. In our case, by the way, bench and digital environments and social butterflies, there is a kind of a digital zeitgeist around. And also for us to catch this digital zeitgeist, at the end, this is our core business. Whether we are able constantly to follow what's going on.
I'd like to challenge you on that a bit, because if you look at, think of the digital natives, if you look at Mark Zuckerberg, for example, this t-shirt would work rather well, I guess. Yeah, maybe, I guess it would work. Great t-shirt, and that's it. That's like a uniform. No serendipity at all.
Today, yes. Yeah, why not? But one day, the way you combine it, the way you change your look, could then take it into a serendipity thing. So, because if you take all the single items, you can take this pants, you can take t-shirt, sweatshirt, hoodie, whatever it is. On the other hand, first of all, you can improve, stylish, put a lot of creativity in the single piece. And then that today's world is everything about styling. Styling in a new look. To appear and to express your own personality in the way you style yourself.
Do Germans need more education than other people in styling and fashion?
This is a question where often whether people are the French or Italians, are they more advanced in fashion? At least the gap closes. There is one, and this is the question which every 3 years, people are asked, German men, are you interested in fashion? If you asked this question 20 years ago, I think the answer, yes, I'm interested in fashion, was 69% said yes. 69% 20 years ago, yes. If you ask today, 89, 90, 91% say yes, I'm interested in fashion. In so far, interest is a prerequisite for everything. And so far, also German men came closer to fashion.
Kind of a learning curve in the male population. There is still hope.
Yes.
Okay. Let's take a look once more at social media. You're working a lot, as you told us before, with Snapchat.
Right.
Why Snapchat?
Snapchat allows, especially social butterflies, to bring in their own creativity. They change the picture they shoot. At the end, Snapchat is a camera, and the only camera you can do your own whatever you do. And this is then your own personality, creativity you bring into that. That simple is it.
Do you use Snapchat?
Yes, yes.
What's your favorite filter?
I play around a little bit. I'm more the guy who is following, who is looking what others do. So insofar, I don't have a favorite filter. I'm open and get inspired. And I just try crazy things. You know. But Snapchat, for me today, is the hot thing. The only thing where you can, in a very easy way, share with others a kind of a substance, whatever the substance is, with your own add-on creativity.
Mm-hmm. The thing about Snapchat is that, for example, you post a series of pictures there from a shooting, from a musical event, and it stays there for 24 hours, and then it's gone.
Yeah.
So in each and every idea of long-term loyalty, long-term marketing, that's a nightmare for regular marketing people. Why do you think it's an advantage?
The advantage is it opens up what you like to share. There are no entry barriers because you know 24 hours, it's out. And you are, in a way, you are constantly on the way to produce new things. Mm-hmm. So I think it had more advantages than disadvantages. This is exactly that there is no need to think, if I do something and then after 3 months, still people could see what I did. People in today's world, in this crowd, especially in our then fashion styling thing, is a question of today, of now, mm-hmm. and not what was last week. Our crowd, our people live today. What can I do tomorrow? What do I share now? Mm-hmm. People are less interested about discussions what happened 4 days ago.
Mm-hmm. So if you get in touch like you told us via social media, via being there, typical real life experiences, festivals and so on, you probably in a way also use your target group or however we want to put it as influencers for your company strategy, for your product development, like open innovation.
Absolutely.
Could you give us an example of something you did because a customer told you or gave you some clue about what he or she wanted?
Absolutely. What we try is we sum up all the feedbacks from all the social media channels, mm-hmm. Share it with our designers first, and then second, we do initiatives where we say, look, this kind of piece, do you like it? Do you want it in a different way? This kind of things. Then, third, we very much believe in a development process in fashion, which can be immediately felt via mobile. So because quite often for this crowd, the first approach to fashion is what they see on mobile. So, and thinking and acting as a designer via mobile is a completely different thing than it always was. A designer thinks, this is a fantastic fabric. I see this in a model. I see this three-dimensional, things like that. So, there is a new kind of know-how of designers coming up, and this is they have a feeling for an impression fashion on mobile. This is where we are trying to follow exactly that kind of movement of our community.
And those feedbacks, this input just comes via the social media channels.
Yes.
What about connecting those experiences with real life experience, like the shop experience? Do you think people won't go to shops anymore in like 10 years, or can we integrate those two worlds?
I still believe in stores. Okay, let's say today, fashion as a channel, more than 20% of people buy fashion via online. Still 80% is brick sales. So even if one day, let's say the online sales is 40%, but it will never be more than half. Still, people want to have that kind of real-life experience going in the center of the city. They might change. Stores and areas in cities are then more entertainment areas. But even in 20 years, let's say then half of the business will be offline, and then half online in our industry, fashion. So this means the development and what we do still has to do both. to develop all what is online, social media, mobile, especially mobile, and then still improve the kind of experience, entertaining level of a store.
Are you experimenting with virtual reality? Because this could be an interesting aspect in integrating those worlds.
Yes. This, for everybody, could be the new big thing. Mm-hmm. Everybody, including us, is at a very first stage. But exactly this virtual reality, so what can be felt without going there in real life, but more than it today's digital world. So this is exactly this in-between area. Everybody today is at a very first stage in the thinking.
Also experiencing yourself in trying on clothes in different worlds, like evening dinner party, business, office, festival,
right.
could be one idea in
exactly.
applying virtual reality.
Exactly. Yeah, you can create different worlds and worlds where you have an experience not on a daily basis, because more or less everybody has his experience, let's say, in a daily work, and then, let's say, clubbing a little bit. Mm-hmm. But on that side, you can experience yourself and how you feel and see yourself in these different kind of virtual realities. A very interesting future. Again, everybody is today at a starting point.
I need an advice. I had a party a few weeks ago, and in the invitation it said dress code casual. And inviting around 120 people, you get 120 emails, text messages, WhatsApp messages or calls asking you what is casual. Do you think this will dissolve this standardization of fashion representation in different environments, or will this still be there?
I think I'm not surprised about your experience, because people know when they go out, when they meet, then either it's formal or let's say business casual or so. Today, business casual people would know how they dress. They would wear jeans and a jacket and so on. So if you say casual, people still are a little bit lost, because this opens up to everything. Insofar, I have to say it the other way around. I think these kind of wordings, formal, business casual, informal or casual, they will stay as a kind of how do we describe what we are wearing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There is one general trend, I think, which is more important. There is today, and this will not walk away, a very big freedom of how people can dress, and it's still okay. More or less, in all environments, even in big DAX companies.
If you're not a banker, that's the
exception. Even in the banking industry, at least, they moved, I'm forced to wear a tie, to I'm not forced. Mm-hmm. To wear a tie any longer. Now you might say, okay, this is a small step, but it's a step. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm quite happy when I see people around and also flying here and there. On average today, including Germany, the dress level is much higher and better than it was ever before. Mm-hmm.
You said people sometimes get lost without these categories like business casual. That's interesting, because fashion is a representation of my individuality, be it like that or like that. And so the development, the millennium generation will show us, just opens up everything a bit. That's what I understand.
Exactly. Yeah, in fashion, these kind of guys opens up a more free world for everybody else. So far, it's a very good direction.
Last question, advice to me. What do I need to change first?
Stay like it is. Perfect.
Thank you.
Styling-wise, color-wise.
Thank you very much. That's relaxing. Thank you for your interest to the audience, and thank you, Bruno,
for
this conversation.
So, vielen Dank.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Mia Meckel and Bruno Seltzer. Very interesting conversation.
So good to have you here, and we will be right back in a few minutes, what we called with the Leaders Talk. We will have on stage Tom Bude and Caroline Everson. Tom talking for Nestle, Caroline for Facebook, and they are already backstage, and we are more than happy to welcome you guests coming right now to the Congress Hall. So give us 2 minutes, and then we will continue with Connections That Count, presented by Anna Beger from the IAB. Connections That Count, the Leaders Talk in 2 minutes.